I'm Alan Kenny, and we're in New York for REIT Week 2017, Nareit's Investor Forum. I'm joined by Phil Owens, Managing Director with Green Street's Advisory Group.
So Phil, obviously there's a lot of talk about the retail sector going on right now. How do you see investment managers executing on their trades in that space?
Right. So certainly retail is an area of disproportionate focus in the retail space, and certainly in the real estate space as well. So what we're seeing is really a focus on the retailers, but the retailers don't offer you a lot of trading advantages. So people are trying to find other areas where they can find informational advantages. Real estate's one of those areas. And specifically malls are an area where people are trying to really dig in to figure out how they can make a play. So what we see there are things like, number one, which malls might be exposed to the weakest retailers? Can I get granular enough to understand which malls are potentially weakest? Number two, what's the occupancy cost of these retailers in these malls? If I can figure out how much rent a tenant is paying as a percentage of their overall sales, I can uncover some hidden strengths or weaknesses in some of those malls that may not be totally transparent. Another area people are paying attention to is the CMBS market. There are about 400 malls, US malls, that have CMBS debt. And there's a treasure trove of information in those CMBS filings if you can put the manpower into extracting it. Another area is shadow supply. And we know about, you know, anchor box vacancies and things like that. But with store closings accelerating, people are really paying attention to that supply-demand dynamic because it relates to how you can charge rent or even maintain the rent that you've got over time. And lastly, REIT share prices give you a bit of a look into investor mentality. Mall REITs are trading at significant discounts to underlying value. And if you can answer the question, gee, if a mall is trading at a 30% discount to underlying value, does it imply that 10% or 50% of that REIT's malls may be challenged? And maybe the story's not as bad as I think, or maybe it's worse. So those are the kinds of things people are paying attention to as they think about making bearish or even, you know, bullish bets on the retail space in real estate.
And Phil, the consensus that I hear from most observers is that the high-quality malls are protected from a lot of the headwinds that are facing retail right now. How do you see players like hedge funds viewing that?
Right now, most of the activity really is focused on the high-quality mall space. Most players are consistent in their view that the weaker malls are going to continue to face ongoing challenges. So in the high-quality mall space, I think it's important to remember that we have to be balanced. Number one, about 60% of mall value resides in the top 200 malls in the country. Those 200 malls are doing relatively well. High-quality mall operators are experiencing 3 to 4% NOI growth this year. Their occupancy is in the low to mid 90% range. They're filling up vacating spaces, and they're collecting data in a way that they've never been able to do in the past, which is allowing them to really create business strategies tailored to each individual mall. So that's the case that sort of bolsters that high-quality malls are going to be fine. Some of the hedge funds and other investment managers have a different point of view, and that point of view sounds something like this. Retailer bankruptcies are accelerating. Shadow space coming onto the market's accelerating. Tenant credit quality is weakening, and their margins are weakening. And at the end of the day, if we don't have a situation where you can backfill a vacancy in a mall the way we have been able to in the past, our current tenant base becomes increasingly important. And if their credit is weakening, we're setting ourselves up for some real challenges going forward. So I think the divergence in points of view at the high-quality mall space is pretty pronounced. But I will say that I think we're seeing some strength at the high-quality malls. And I think that going forward, we're going to continue to see high-quality mall operators adapt in an effective way.
Okay, but this isn't really a new retail story. How's this all going to play out?
I wish we had a perfect lens here, and I wish the crystal ball could give us the exact answer. The reality is that malls are not going away, right? We will see some malls go away. Some lower quality malls will not exist in the future, but high quality malls are going to be around, and they're going to look very different from the way they look today. You know, we did some studying looking back 20 years on what current malls looked like back then, and it was shocking to see how much change had happened. And I'm guessing if you did the same exercise 20 years prior to that, you'd have the same conclusion. So malls are going to look different in the future. That's number one. Number two, we've got mall operators that are well-funded, generally very sophisticated, and very focused on making sure that their assets stay relevant in the marketplace. This is not new to them. This ever-constant change in retail is going to continue to be the case. But I think right now, at this point in the market, if you're willing to roll your sleeves up and do the hard work, there are some pots of gold at the end of the rainbow for those willing to get their hands dirty.
Well, Phil, thanks so much for your time.
Pleasure. Thank you.
For more on this and other real estate news and analysis, be sure to visit REIT.com.